now! Hello humans, my name is Dael Kingsmill, and ordinarily I am very firmly of the belief, let's get this out there right up top of the video, I am firmly of the belief that you know, D&D is a tabletop RPG that is designed for, you know, evoking a certain kind of fantasy game. And that generally, if you want a game to really give you the experience of a different genre, that you're gonna have to go to another game system. That is typically my stance, that is typically how I feel. You can't play Pokemon using the 5th edition rules, you just can't. But, look, recently on the Eldritch Lorecast, which, if you don't know, it's a podcast with a panel of hosts, of which I am one. We got James Hake, we got Sean Merwin, we got Ben Byrne. If you're interested in like game design, I think that the podcast has a lot of really cool, valuable, interesting discussion about game design stuff. So check it out. This is our most recent episode as of the time of me filming this. I believe that this is the episode where we discussed fables, we discussed digital tabletop tools, and we discussed scented candles. Okay, but on topic. Recently, we had a little conversation that dipped into the idea that you can't or perhaps shouldn't run horror games with the 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons rules. So I've had, sort of since about Halloween, in the back of my head, this thought process of like, horror and 5th edition, does it work? In that span of time, a couple of things have come up. First, I was reading a post on the Alexandrian. There was an entry there by Justin Alexander that talked about horror and what's important to running a horror game. And the idea of balancing player agency with player loss of control. That was one thing. Another thing that happened is I watched Scream for the first time. You may know I'm not the biggest horror buff in the world. I'm a bit of a scaredy cat, but I am fascinated with the horror genre and the techniques involved. Scream is a meta horror and it got me thinking about the tropes of horror films, and it all kind of just congealed, coalesced, congregated in my mind, and I then went into sort of a fever state putting together a really simple way to play 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons, leaving most of the rules untouched, but to have it feel like a teen horror slasher film. Maybe not specifically slasher, but slasher was at the forefront of my mind. So I want to show you what I've come up with, but also I want you to keep in mind while we're doing this, another thing that came up on the Eldritch Lorecast not too long ago was the idea, we were talking about the way in which different sort of fantasies, not the genre fantasy, but the thing like, oh, I wish this were the case, right? Certain fantasies can be achieved through different mechanics. Spell casting, right? The idea of casting a spell, different mechanics in different systems will all feel like casting a spell, but they might make it feel a little bit different. You might have a really granular system of spell casting that makes it seem like spell casting is complicated and academic and mathical. Mathical? On the other hand, you might have a fairly simple spellcasting system. The system in 5th edition, for example, makes spellcasting feel a little bit more simple, straightforward, from the hip, a little bit more innate. But the point is, you can take one idea and you can express that through different game rules and systems. And on the flip side, on the reverse of that, you can also take one system of rules or mechanics and it can represent different fantasies depending on how you present that same piece of information. So I want you to keep that in mind. That's going to be pretty significant as we go through this. I think you'll get it. I'm excited for you to get it. I think you will. And you know what? Let me just say right now, okay, I understand. Go play Dread. I will play Dread. We'll all enjoy Dread. We'll enjoy all the spooky games. This was like an exercise of me realizing, actually, I don't think that 5th edition's rule system is particularly incompatible with the horror genre. And this was me just messing around to see if I could make that true. So, let's take a look. Okay, so, actual rules changes. I tried my very best to keep these to an absolute minimum, okay? And in fact, the rule change that I did make, I stole from someone on Twitter. I don't remember who it was, Someone in the comments probably does remember who it was. Thank you to that person. Someone wise on Twitter once said, if you want to try running a horror game in D&D, try having the GM track the character's hit points instead of the characters. So anytime the characters take damage, you just describe it narratively. You note for yourself what their hit points are at, but the players don't know how low their health is getting. It just adds that extra oomph of like, okay, you don't know when you're gonna die. You could die just around the next corner, which is essential for the horror experience. In my humble opinion, it's time for Dael's opinion. So that's the main thing that I'm working with here. That in itself is not really actually a rules change. That's a very small change. I did make some other changes with regards to health. So one thing that I did, I mean, I also started calling hit points, I started calling it luck instead, because I like that idea of your luck has run out. It really sort of pulls it out of a zone of it being meat. So when you have hit zero hit points, which are not hit points anymore, when you've hit zero, you've run out of luck. But you don't know that you've run out of luck. Now that's all that happens, okay? You do not fall unconscious. You're still standing, you still work perfectly fine. You can move, you can attack, you can do all those things. But when you are out of luck, the next time that you take damage, boom. You're down. You're down. I was tempted to say that you die, because that does feel right, but there's always some characters, particularly in slasher films, who you think are dead, but then they're not dead. They were just left for dead. So instead, I think that the next time you take damage after you've hit zero luck, either right then or maybe at the beginning of your next turn, you make a single death saving throw. It's not three saving throws like we're used to. It is one and done. If you fail that death saving throw, your character is dead. If you do not fail that saving throw, your character is just unconscious and they'll be back later. What I think would be a really cool way to do this as well, because, you know, horror is such a high death genre that I don't think you can't compromise on that, right? But something that I think would be cool to do is that usually in these kinds of films, you kind of have ascended NPCs. So if you think about Scream, I don't know if you've seen it, but if you have, you've got your main group of teen characters who are doing their thing and they die along the way, right? You also have a couple of characters hanging around that ordinarily might be regarded as NPCs. You've got Dewey, the cop, and you have Gale, the reporter. By the end of that film, spoiler alert, those two have kind of risen in prominence to become very significant characters. I think it would be neat if you were playing this style of game, if when a character dies, you just have a bunch of NPCs ready to go that you've been playing. Like, they come up in the game like NPCs do, but when one of the core party members dies, you can say to the player, okay, which of the NPCs do you want to take control of? And they become the small town sheriff, or they become this nosy reporter, and they get embroiled in all of the happenings as well. I also suspect that there should be something in place in terms of how one regains hit points. Like, either you can only regain hit points after a long rest, or you can only regain hit points by spending hit dice. But you know, your mileage may vary there. And maybe it's fine even without restrictions on regenerating HP. But I don't know. The other actual rules change is that players do not choose a background during character creation. Now, okay, I think this part's kind of neat. Remember what I said earlier about mechanics and fantasies. I wanted this to sit in the zone of teen horror. Fairly modern teen horror. Okay, so we're talking all of the teenage stereotypes. And all I've done is create really simple character classes, you know, like we have fighter, bard, cleric. And what I've done instead is, instead of players choosing from the player's handbook character classes, they choose from these ones. The delinquent, the geek, the goofball, the jock, the prep, and one that I am currently calling the saint. I don't know, it's tricky to find a perfect name for it. What I'm talking about is the final girl, but I didn't want it to be gendered like that. I didn't want to enforce that idea of, oh, well, if you play this class, you have to be a girl. So it's like, you know, the final girl, the boy scout, the you know, friendly next door kid, that character archetype who's just a little bit straight-laced. But Dael, you said that this was simple, that there were no rules changes. This sounds like a full-on change to the system. I'll tell you why you're wrong. Literally all I've done is steal class features from other classes and put them together in different combinations. And because I give them different titles, suddenly it feels like it's a different thing. So now the delinquent is made up mostly of barbarian stuff, I believe. It's got a little bit of rogue in there. So the delinquent gets reckless attack, survival instinct, sucker punch, retaliation, tooth and nail, and won't stay down. Now look at it, look at it. You will recognize all of these features from other places. I just changed the names. Maybe in a place or two I altered the wording to make it non-specific to the original class, or I might have smooshed a couple things together here and there, but I didn't create anything new for this. Except I guess some cool titles. Something you will notice, there are only 5 levels worth of features here. Yes, there are 6 features, but there's 5 levels worth of features. I don't think that a slasher film context sort of genre approach can sustain itself for all that long. So 5 levels worth of stuff, that to me is plenty. Particularly because this is the sort of thing that someone might want to run as a one-shot, or possibly like a recurring series of one-shots. So there are 2 variations on how I thought this might be approached. Either play it up like it's sequels, so everyone who survives the original one-shot can come back for another one at a later time that is the sequel, because there's inevitably a sequel, and those characters have all leveled up! And so just over time they're getting better and better, and also more and more likely to survive the next movie. You know, making Ripley even harder to kill. We don't talk about the third movie. Or, something I thought could be really fun, is the idea that, during the one-shot, every time the characters take a short rest, you know, every time they've survived a close encounter with the villain, they level up! Easy as that, quick as that. So at the start of the session, it sort of is slowly building because there's only so much that they can do. But by the time you get towards the end of the session, everyone has a little bit more in their arsenal that they can put into finally taking down this thing that's hunting them. Okay, neat. The geek has gifted and talented, quick thinking, part-time tutor, fix-it, puzzle solver, and tinkerer. These things that make up the geek, they are pulled mostly from the artificer and the rogue. The goofball has fluke, yammer, make 'em laugh, bring out the best, and summon courage. So this is made up of like a bunch of bard stuff, as well as it's got the halfling luck ability in there. That idea that this class clown just kind of clumsily stumbles their way out of trouble. Instead of Song of Rest, which has these connotations of, oh yes, it's peaceful and I'm helping you heal, it's now just like, you're taking their mind off it. Sure, we're being hunted by Jason with a machete, but you know, if you can make them laugh, it'll make them feel a bit better. Which, by the way, reinforces the flavor switch for the mechanics of HP to luck. It takes it away from this idea of meat and makes it like, oh no, okay, I'm just feeling better now. The jock is pretty much all fighter stuff. It was such a quick fit. What I really liked doing, I swapped fighting style for star athlete, and I basically just had to change the name of a bunch of the fighting styles. Instead of defensive as a fighting style, you have football. While wearing armor, you gain a +2 bonus to AC. I think in the actual rules it's a +1 bonus, but I've always hated that, so I changed it because I had the opportunity to change it. Instead of great weapon fighting, you have baseball, because someone who uses a baseball bat all the time is probably good at hitting stuff hard. So I just changed the names of most of them. A couple of them I think I did create. I added cheerleading because I wanted to again reinforce the idea that this is not super gendered. I know that we typically see jocks in these films as masculine, but I wanted to stick something that is associated with femininity in there so that people know. But of course, having said that, if you're playing a girl jock, you don't have to play a cheerleader. I feel, you get it, right? And also I did give these names of specific sports like baseball, but if you decided that your character plays hockey instead, you can probably just take the baseball feature and just call it hockey. The jock also gets fighting spirit, competitive edge, second wind, and the best defense. The best defense is an extra attack, because the best defense is good offense. Note as well that for some of these, like on the delinquent and the jock, some of the abilities kept the same name that they originally had because it still fits. The barbarian makes a reckless attack, the delinquent makes a reckless attack. That fits, that jives with the new flavor. The prep, this one was fun to do. So the prep, by that I mean, you know, Tatum from Scream, or, I mean for a non-horror example, Elton from Clueless. The prep's abilities include whatever. I liked naming that one. Social currency, catch me if you can. Self-defense, hey you, and vicious mockery. There's a cool little tag team of features here, self-defense and hey you. So self-defense, the idea is that if something comes at you, you can hit it. And just in that moment, you will hit better than you hit usually. And then team that up with, hey, you. One of the crew is getting attacked by the monster and you go, hey, ugly. And they turn around and they attack you instead. Love to live out those tropes. Vicious mockery. I feel like that speaks for itself. All right, the saint. So the saint is kind of made up of abilities that make you harder to kill, because it's based on the idea of the final girl, right? But also being sort of gentle and nurturing, and the transformation into the heroic sort of action girl when you need to decapitate Pamela Voorhees at the end of the film. So you've got favored by fate, something's not right, gentle hands, will to live, hard to kill, and fight back. And you'll note that as you get further through, so that idea of like, you're coming into your own by the end of the movie. If you were doing that one shot where every time you take a rest, you level up, by the end you get this like one shot thing of sneak attack. Hits them over the back of the head, or, you know, stabs them with their own weapon from behind. And that ability appears towards the end of the film, as it were. I think that at this point, you could easily just kind of call it a day, run a game like this, and I think it would feel more like horror. Consider everyone playing non-variant humans. I think that would be the most fun if you really want to replicate a teen slasher. I replaced the equipment that is available to people with stuff like baseball bats and knives and scissors and a wood axe and stuff, like a stun gun and a chainsaw. And armor all got replaced with stuff like, you know, motorcycle leathers and you know, football helmets and stuff. I just had to swap out the equipment. It was not difficult to do. I think you absolutely could just run it with the D&D core races. I don't think it would be a big problem. I think there's an instinct that tells us that in order to run horror, you have to remove the sort of dark vision that a lot of character races have, but I mean, I'm not convinced that it would actually be a problem. Like, if you want to alter those races in order to use them for this, then go for it. If you would rather it just be non-variant humans, go for it. You could even use the equipment at, like, if you wanted to do horror like this, but, you know, in a typical D&D fantasy setting, you could just keep all the equipment the same, right? Chuck him into any dungeon. It feels a little spookier, a little scarier, a little more in touch with the tropes of the horror genre. But I have some thoughts on how you might run villains to be a little bit more like a slasher. Take any classic monster from the Monster Manual. Maybe doesn't even have to be classic, but the ones I've been looking at have been like a demon, a ghost, wouldn't this work great with my ghost system? My ghost system. A mummy. That could be interesting. You could easily apply this to something like The Mummy, like the Brendan Fraser movies, right? Look at these classes. Evie is the geek. Her brother is the goofball. You might think that Rick is the jock, but I think that he's the delinquent. Scarecrow, vampire, werewolf, witch, zombies, or of course, just a guy with a knife. If I was to run this, I think what I would do is basically pick one of those bad guys, right? Say I pick a vampire. Then pick whether the goal for the player characters is to escape, survive, or defeat, destroy. Because that kind of tends to be what happens in horror movies, right? You've got your cubes and escape rooms where you're just trying to get out of the place, sort of haunted house type movies. Survive, a lot of, you know, zombie apocalypse ones are this, or, you know, there's some terrible event that is happening, you just have to make it through to the other end. Or of course, defeat, destroy, you have to kill the bad guy. So say I chose vampire, right? I have a choice of escape. Maybe you have to escape Dracula's castle. Survive, maybe you just have to survive until dawn. Maybe it's one night that you're just trying to survive this vampire. Or of course, kill the vampire, defeat Dracula, stake him through his heart. So you've picked your bad guy, you've picked your goal. For the sake of this, I will choose defeat the villain. You have to kill Dracula. You're gonna need three things to do it. Sort of a three-step process, almost like a ritual that they have to find the aspects for before they can complete the task. You have to find Dracula's coffin, okay? You have to get Dracula into the coffin, and you have to stake him through the heart. Those don't have to be the things. You can pick any number of things. Pull from the tropes, pull from, you know, garlic has to be involved, running water, grave dirt, whatever you like. Ghost, you could use the sort of ritual that I talked about before, you know, something like you have to figure out the ghost's name, you have to seal it in a circle of salt so it can't leave the circle, and then you have to read the ancient rite of Azeroth in order to banish the spirit. I don't know, something like that. Just pick three things that they have to be able to achieve that gives them like a direction. Where are you going? What are you trying to do? Meanwhile, the villain will show up and try to kill them, obviously. And if you're looking at these stat blocks of these monsters I'm talking about, they're gonna win. But here's the difference. Every time that villain takes, say, I don't know, 20, 25 points of damage from the party, they sort of swoosh away to lick their wounds to get ready to make another attack. This is pretty universal of any of these horror movies. Dracula could do it. A killer with a knife could do it. A ghost could do it. They just vanish away, ready to manifest and spook the party again later on. Another really cool factor of this is that it gives you more opportunities for players to run out of luck without realizing it, and the next time the bad guy shows up, they come in and kill that character, and that's how the combat starts, which is something that you do see a lot in horror films. Consider when you're talking about things like zombies that come in a horde, right? The party could be attacked by a whole horde of zombies at the one time, and the idea is that once you do 25 points worth of damage, you have defeated that pocket, that cell of zombies. So I don't know, this is a thing that I've been tinkering with. I found it a lot of fun to mess around with, to just be like, I wonder how I can make 5th edition a fantasy game into a horror game with sort of really minimal changes. Some of them may look like they are not minimal on the surface, but I did not create anything new in order to make this work. So yeah, basically, I mean, totally go play Dread, but I'm just saying, you could make 5th edition a horror game. We hit 100,000 subscribers! A lot of you joined me for a live stream celebration that we did. I carved a watermelon just like old times. People were afraid, just like old times. It was just like old times. I'm blown away. It's really mind-boggling to try and wrap my brain around it, but thank you. Thank you so much for everyone who subscribed and who's stuck around for such a long time. This is something that I announced during the live stream. When I was a wee babby YouTuber, when I hit maybe 5,000 subscribers and I thought, shoot, that's like a lot of people. Which it is, it's a lot of people. I thought to myself, if I ever hit 20,000 subscribers, I'll come out with some merch for my channel. I didn't do that, but we've hit 100 and we have merch now! Woo! There'll be a link to the website if you want to go check that out. We have this. This is the Monarchs Factory crown and Gears logo design that was done for me by Matt Batt. I mean, I designed the logo, but Matt Batt did this design with the logo. It comes on t-shirts and hoodies. And we also have this design. This is Vague and Evocative, designed by Luke Comstock. It is one of my favorite things of all time. I love how it looks on the burgundy. The jumpers are super, I'm really happy with the jumpers. The shirts are great too, don't get me wrong. So you can go check those out if you are interested. If you do want to buy stuff, make sure that you look at the sizing chart, because the actual like letter sizing is a little bit wild. So definitely check the sizing chart when you're purchasing. So that's very exciting. It's really weird to have Monarchs Factory written on the jumper I'm wearing, but it's a thrill. I love it. Apart from that, I do believe that's it. I'm done. Email this to thy grandmother. That got weird, I'm sticking with it. Trust me to come up with a Halloween horror movie concept like 2 weeks after Halloween. Of course I did.